Hi, I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. We have a new set and we have a new year, and we're going to call this Health Matters. We are very lucky to have an especially talented part of the healthcare community in New York, Dr. Sara Brenner. She is she has a title at the Nanotechnology Center here in Albany that is especially challenging. Vice President for Nanohealth Initiatives and an assistant professor. Nanotechnology, which Dr. Brenner will soon explain, is a whole new arena for both science and for health. New York is especially blessed because of some good judgment by people investing a lot of money in SUNY Albany to have a nanotechnology center. In fact, $1 billion. It's a magnificent looking building. I'm going to parlay this show into getting an invitation to get a tour. But more importantly, for science in general, for health in general, nanotechnology. Dr. Brenner, welcome. Maybe you can
Thank
just
you.
Start to tell us a little bit about the field in general before we get to its application to health.
You bet. So you hear nanotechnology a lot, especially in this region. And nanotechnology essentially is the ability and know-how to change matter and manipulate matter at a very small scale, between 1 and 100 nanometers. And when you're able to change matter at that level, new properties will evolve, and you'll be able to use those properties to develop materials and tools and technologies that we've never seen before. A lot of people are familiar with electronics products and even energy products that use nanotechnology as part of the research, development, and product line. But looking forward into the future, energy and healthcare will be enormous areas where we see great potential to advance the tools and technologies that we use today.
Well, we're always talking about small things in health, the viruses, the bacteria, our cells. But you're bringing a whole new way of looking at those small things.
That's right. So as you point out, many different entities in biology already exist at a very small scale. Those are natural entities. When we're changing matter and material using nanotechnology, we can start to interact with those cells and bacteria and viruses that you mentioned in an intentional way, either to cure a disease, to treat a disease, or diagnose it. And so when we combine nanotechnology with medicine, we get the word nanomedicine, and that would be the application of those tools for either the prevention, the diagnosis, or the treatment of any variety of diseases.
Well, for instance, they're talking now about drugs that would be suited to an individual, a cancer, something that would be directed towards the source of that cancer in one's body. Is that nanotechnology or is that conventional?
That is absolutely a great area of application for nanotechnology. And what you mentioned in terms of the personalization is our ability to see and target very specific, very small on the nanoscale features in an individual's tumor or their cancer site. So developing a drug, for example, that is targeted just to their cancer, or we can get to the site of their cancer to deliver its payload of a drug, provides incredible therapeutic benefit and also reduces or has the potential to reduce the side effects that would be associated with delivering that drug.
Does nanotechnology allow us to do a good, not only delivery, but a good analysis of what would be going on in a person's tumor?
You bet. And there are a variety of ways that we're already looking at doing that. At the College of Nanoscale Science and Engineering, we do quite a bit of research and development in computer chips or nanoelectronics. Those chips can be used in the biology world, in the healthcare world, to do exactly what you're saying, and that is to monitor the progression of a disease, to diagnose what type of disease, for example, what type of cancer, what the individual's genetic code is in that cancer, and also to track the migration or metastasis of cells away from a tumor site. So the combination of the nanoelectronics world, the silicon world, with the wet world, which is water-based, is an area that we're exploring. And it's
very exciting. You can actually take some type of genome reading, which is a wet world, and put that on a chip, which is a silicone world. Mm-hmm. So therefore, you could examine the information that came from an individual by silicone chip?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And how would you use that chip? You're not just using a microscope. You're putting it through some type of electric detection.
Right. What you're getting at is that it's very complex, and you must integrate many different disciplines and many different scientists with backgrounds in everything from biology to electrical engineering to physics to make that whole system work and have that whole system talk to each other. So when you have cells that are migrating and they're coming into contact with an electronic chip, then you have to have output. That chip has to survive in a biological world. Then you need people to interpret what that means. So that's the parlay into healthcare, the healthcare community that would then take that electronic information and put it in the context of that patient's health and what's happening with them. Ideally, that information would then help the physician make a quicker diagnosis, a more accurate diagnosis, and come up with a better treatment plan that is tailored to that individual, and that it would also lead to the highest likelihood of recovery and long-term success for that patient.
One of the problems, we often thought when they decoded the human genome, mm-hmm. that we would know everything about the human genome.
Right.
And it turns out that by the time you get through analyzing an individual cell, mm-hmm. that there's more components of that cell. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking of the folding of that. And it's just like taking crumpled paper and then mm-hmm. trying to measure the surface of each piece of the crumpled paper and the computing. And I often thought that was a huge challenge for what we do in computing now. But it seems to me that what nanotechnology offers you is a way to skip through that and to get to actual knowledge of what's going on in part of a cell.
There's a tremendous amount that we know and that we don't know. And the more we know, as they say often in philosophy and sometimes in politics, the more you know, the more you realize you don't know.
Right.
So absolutely, as our computing power is increasing, our ability to gain information, store information, synthesize information from the biological world is ever increasing. And it's increasing exponentially, which is part of why it's such an exciting field to be in, a bit scary at times, just because the pace of innovation and the pace of knowledge is off of the charts. But we see unlimited potential to combine, you know, the computing power that you mentioned with our new understanding of biology and health systems.
Well, and this, the way you're going about it, you're going to have to do lots of collaboration.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you have a building out there. I said it was impressive before. It's about a football field and a half long, and it must be 8 stories, 5 stories high. I've never gotten up close.
Well, you should come for a tour, like you mentioned.
I will. I'd love to. But it seems to me that there's, A, you have to do a lot of things there, mm-hmm. but then there's expertise throughout the state. Mm-hmm. Cornell has it even mm-hmm. before they get to build whatever they're going to build in New York City.
Right.
We have it at Stony Brook. We have it at Cold Spring Harbor. We have it at North Shore, LIJ. Mm-hmm. They each have research centers that probably have different specialties in looking at parts of it mm-hmm. and could benefit by what nanotechnology could offer.
Absolutely, and what you've alluded to there is that New York State has tremendous resources, and certainly the governor has tremendous vision in pulling those together and trying to leverage the intellectual capital of all of the researchers, the industry presence in public-private partnership building, and really all of that combined with Albany being the hub for nanotechnology R&D puts New York State in a tremendous position to lead the charge in the 21st century.
There'll be a lot of spin-offs from this, right? I mean, there'll be companies, but and so have you spun any off yet, or is it too soon? Is it premature to say that?
Certainly, there have been successes. There have been partnerships and also spin-offs. The individual faculty who are leading those efforts would be better able to speak about them specifically. We could follow up about that. Certainly in the biology world, the healthcare world, the industries who are at the table with medicine are many, for one, but they're also pretty diverse. They might be medical material makers, they might be drug makers, they might be monitoring device sorts of folks. So the healthcare world in terms of companies and public-private partnerships is a vast landscape with many different types of players, big, small, all angling for different types of products to benefit us in the healthcare world.
So the more we could sponsor them, the more we could get them to there's past and staying in New York is a good thing.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah,
because
absolutely.
Because I always say that the more we can use our brains, that becomes our new factories. So we don't have to pollute the atmosphere, but we can certainly benefit.
It's a way to look at it, yeah.
But yourself, you're an example of master's in public health, mm-hmm. a physician,
correct.
And a researcher in nanotech.
Right.
you're the precursor of what we're going to need as new professionals. Doctors are not just not going to be the same.
I believe that that is very true, and I think we'll see it in our lifetimes. One of the answers to that charge, which I see coming down the pike, the college has actually built with SUNY Downstate Medical Center. So we now offer an MD, PhD program in nanomedicine. It's the only one of those in the world that we're aware of. And this generation of professionals will graduate with both a medical degree and a PhD in nanobioscience.
And how long will that take?
7 years, at
wow.
least.
wow.
Yeah, so it's a very long haul. There's a lot to know. There's a lot to learn. But professionals of the future, as you just mentioned, will have tremendous skills in many different disciplines and fields. So they'll be able to sit in a world where nanobioscience is happening and have the tools at their disposal of nanotechnology and also the medical expertise to say, now we're going to transition these tools across what would have been a traditional barrier and apply them in this world. That kind of professional in the future will rapidly change the way we do business in healthcare.
Can you give me some examples of that? I mean, I know that it's all there as a potential, mm-hmm. but how will it be for the ordinary care of somebody with the flu? Mm-hmm. Or how is it going to be with somebody with a condition like we read in the New York Times that they run every week in their magazine section?
You bet.
You know all those different things that Puzzling to
people. Let's take an example that most people are familiar with, such as type 2 diabetes. So that's one of the major causes of both morbidity and mortality in the U.S. and certainly in a lot of first world countries today. So in the progression of diabetes, you can prevent, you can diagnose, you can treat. In terms of prevention, glucose monitoring sensors, the types of computer chips we talked about, there are many companies, many folks trying to develop sensors that could test glucose non-invasively, say over the skin or even with an implantable device. In terms of diagnosis, there will be easier ways and quicker ways to diagnose folks who have diabetes or the complications of diabetes, which include things like kidney failure and a bunch of other stuff. And then in terms of treatment, a lot of folks, unfortunately, we've missed the traditional healthcare system misses a lot of opportunities to intervene with disease. And when you have a patient who needs, say, an organ transplant like a kidney, nanotechnology is working on ways to actually build artificial tissues and potentially whole organs for implantation. Kidneys are just one good example because we run short on kidneys. Many more people need kidneys than we have.
Oh, we have a waiting list over 70,000.
Right, and I know you've had interest in been involved in organ donorship.
Yeah.
So one way to go about it, just by way of example, is organs that have been harvested and will be implanted. There's a fine window of opportunity to do that. One of our professors, for example, is working with a company to put a chip on there, nanotechnology again, to test the viability or the likelihood of success of transplanting that organ. That's one way to go about it. The new age way to go about it would be to just build a tissue from scratch. And there are companies and researchers already building nanoscaffolds, populating those with cells, growing them now to the size of about a soup can. And when you get to a device that small, you could put that in a patient. And you could see them survive for many years.
Shades of being a novelist.
Yeah.
That's an incredible portrayal of what's possible in the future.
Yeah, that's just one disease. That's just one disease. And we're working on all types of applications
and
for
even
diseases.
What you just said about the non-invasive testing for the mm-hmm. glucose, that just right there can do more mm-hmm. in saving future. We've run out of time. I thank you for joining with us.
You bet.
Maybe we could get you and your colleagues sometime again, but you've actually been most informative. Dr. Brenner, I thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks for tuning in. I'll see you again next time.